So it's my privilege this morning to welcome you to church. And I don't know how you feel. First service was really kind of emotional. I've been thinking over the past several weeks. We've been through a financial concern, and that, of course, continues. We've been through a pandemic, and I have not even been your pastor for one full year yet. I don't know if it's me, but if not, we're going to blame our salad. So welcome this morning. It's good to see you face-to-face, or face-to-mask, and I am so excited that you're here. We've had a good day. You know, we did not know what to expect. We didn't know how many to expect, so we prepared as if everybody was coming, and I think it's a good thing. We want you to be safe, and that's okay. Making noise as a child is perfectly fine. It doesn't bother anyone. Sounds good, in fact. So we're glad you're here, and welcome in the name of Jesus Christ to worship. There is something different about being here, isn't it? This is home. This is our sanctuary where we gather to worship God and to celebrate birthdays and anniversaries and to cry together when someone passes away or something sorrowful happens. It's home. So welcome home to all of you. It's a good place to be. And as I've said to you many times, people are at different places in this. I talked to my sister and brother-in-law and encouraged them to come, and they're not quite ready yet. So if you know people who aren't ready but who want to be here, and who are, you know, it's okay. We understand that. And we just want you to know everyone that the leader Ted is taking, and we love and care about you. You remain a part of this very, very wonderful family. I'd like to say two or three or four things at the start so we kind of get to know what's happening and have an idea as to the plan. And we'll make changes. This is not a perfect plan. It's one that I think has been given a lot of thought. And this is our plan for the days ahead until we get back into normal routine worship where we can do all kinds of the stuff that we do. First of all, we thank you for taking the time to get your temperature taken as you came in the door and to use the hand sanitizer. That's important. So take the time when you come in to do that. Please be sure that if you're not well, it's better to stay at home. Or if your temperature exceeds the limit, we will ask you not to come in. Part of our concern as Christians and as people of faith is for one another. It's not meant to offend or harm anybody, but we are serious about wanting to be within the regulations of our state and of our conference, but also we're concerned about the well-being of all. So please stay healthy and well. That's important for our being together. We want you, as you know, always to wait for an usher to seat you. And that's because there are some of you who come as family units. We call them husbands or wives and children. And they're going to be seated in this section. And we have some of us who are single, and they're going to be in this section. More family and couples over here, except for Diane, who's special. After every service, every event in the life of this room, it will be cleaned. It will be sprayed. Sometimes it will be fogged. Other times it will be sprayed by hand. Both are equally good at killing the virus. The spray, the hand spray, is at 82% alcohol content, and the fogger is at 64, 62, something like that. Both are well above what it needs to kill the virus, and so we want to make sure you know that you can share with others that this is a safe place. During the week, on Thursday, we're here taping, and so after Thursday is done, we'll clean it then. And so every time this room gets used, it gets cleaned. Now, overflow rooms for us, when we get to that place, we have that concern, will be the hospitality room, which is set up for that, the library, the chapel, and when we come inside because it gets too hot, we'll have the parking lot service, we'll probably be meeting in the fellowship hall, and overflow would be in the community room. All of those rooms are cleaned after each use. So we want you to know that we're trying to do the best we can do to be safe. Now you might ask, why am I not wearing a mask? It's because of this. I can't talk clearly enough to be at this pulpit to wear that. And that's why we're physically distant from there and back here with these guys and the choir as well. We cannot sing. I can't sing anyway, but we cannot sing because singing is one of those ways of perhaps having a greater risk of making someone ill. And so, guys, we're really sorry because you all are absolutely beautiful and wonderful as our choir. Sally, you do a tremendous job. Thank you all. And we look forward to the day when we get back and our choir be singing and things, and we'll be excited and celebrate that day and your contribution as well. But thank you for being here and things. They've been singing on the virtual services, which will continue indefinitely. And just so you know, the sermon I preach for the virtual service, the sermon I preach to you this morning is different. So if you want to listen to me twice a week, you have the opportunity. Please know the Monday, Wednesday, and Friday devotions will continue. The Wednesday night event will continue in different formats. All of these things are going to continue. Our bishop has told us that we are one of the three or four churches in this conference that has the largest virtual presence of any church. So we celebrate that. And that's like a fourth congregation. So we're going to be thinking about how we do that well, maybe even better. Bathrooms. Please go to the bathroom before you come. It's like, you know, school. We have closed off the bathrooms. Now, hear this. Nobody is going to be embarrassed. We're not going to do that. But every time between anyone using it, the next person using the bathroom, it has to be cleaned. So if you are able to, you can hold it, hold it. If you have to go, we'll take care of it. But, you know, please know that it's our goal. Yes, sir. Absolutely. It's our goal to do that. And when you exit the building, you came in that door, you're going to be exiting in that direction. And off to the side, you will have the opportunity each Sunday morning until we're back in our normal routine of receiving Holy Communion. That's an important part of our sacrament, and Luann and Jim Trumbull have been just doing a tremendous job, and others too. I mean, I don't want to exclude anybody for that. I also want you to know that I want to say thank you to three or four groups of people, very quickly. First, thank you to you all for being here. At 8 o'clock service, I'm sorry, we had 35. And we usually average between 40 and 50 for that, so I thought they'd be pretty good. Cheer them on, that's right. And for this one, you guys are here, so you get the gold star. So congratulations for that. So thank you for coming. Please tell others what we're doing and how we're doing it so that they know that we're really creating a safe environment the best we can. Secondly, I want to say thank you to a group of volunteers. I am so impressed with this church and its volunteers. You all are very dear to me anyway, and as your pastor, I just want to say thank you. So many people have volunteered to this whole thing of getting back to here, that it's just amazing. It blows my mind. Never once did we lack for a volunteer. And sometimes we've had to say thanks, but we've already done it taken care of. So don't stop that. We want your involvement, and we want you to know that, and I want you to know how appreciative I am. I also want to say thank you to my staff. Now, you hear me say this a lot, and you're going to keep hearing it. It's who I am. I will say to you that this staff has been the best staff that I have served within any appointment I've served. They are here regularly. They're innovative. They're well-thinking. They're doing all they can to advance the cause of this church and the kingdom of God. The idea for drive-through communion idea was not my idea. That was Maud's. Where's your mom? Was here? There she is. Here's Maud. Maud's idea. The idea for having communion each week was Luann and Maud's. The idea for the parking lot church was Maud's. And I have other people. This staff is outstanding. And I hope that you will not only listen to me thank them, but you will take the time to thank them yourselves. One of the realities was this, that before we received PPP money, one of the things we had done was go to the staff and say, we need your presence and your help but we may not be able to pay you. And we're that close, almost. And so every person in the staff said, we'll keep doing what we're doing without that. And that's dedication and commitment, and they have my tremendous respect for that. And we have a group of people here today, are represented here today, who are our graduates. We have 17 graduates, most of whom you'll hear read about or mentioned today. We have two high school graduates who had perfect 4.0 grade point averages throughout their entire high school career. We have one person who has earned his MBA. We have one young lady who is going on for her doctorate in physical therapy. We have Jim's grandsons who are going to be rooming together at the University of Delaware. And you know, we have some awesome graduates. And so I hope you're as proud as I am of these people. And our youth leaders, directors, what do you call yourselves?
Sharon
and Tina. Okay. So we'll tell you all about them. And listen, you might think, well, maybe we should have started this whole thing differently. Now, here's why. We are a family, we're a community, and when one of us mourns or grieves, we all cry. But when one celebrates, we all celebrate. And you know, I've only been here less than a year, we'll be here until July. This is what you and your church accomplished, and along with families and parents and teachers and things. And I want you to be as proud of these ladies and gentlemen as I am.
Congratulate you and wish you the best of luck with your new adventures and the new chapter of your life.
We are so very proud of all of our graduates. They've worked hard. They've had many, many obstacles, as you guys know. They certainly have a story to tell for this year for their graduations. Some got to drive on the boardwalk in Ocean City, which was pretty awesome, I think. And I think you give a shout out to all the school systems, too, that have really tried to make this a special year for them. We know that God got them this far, and he's going to continue to carry them on to really, really great things in their lives. So we're going to start. Michaela Cantine is our first graduate. She's a graduate from Stephen Cater High School, where she earned straight A's all 15 terms of high school. Michaela's a member of our youth group, and she plans to attend Warwick Community College while interning for Dr. Shakir at Peninsula Regional Neurosurgery, where in the her future, she sees herself as a brain surgeon.
Our next graduate is Casey Dent. She also graduated from Stephen Decatur High School. Casey is a member of our youth group. Casey will be taking a gap year to travel and to think about what career she is passionate about pursuing.
Our next graduate is here with us today. Adam, you want to stand up?
Graduated from Snowville High School. Ashton will be attending Methodist University, May majoring in elementary education with a minor in special education or leadership studies. Aisha will also be playing softball for them.
Our next graduate is Sawyer Ellis Ball. He completed his education through homeschooling. He plans to attend Warwick Community College and then transfer to a four-year university. Sawyer wants to become a meteorologist. And anyone that has been to Youth Group or Youth Rally with us, they know that the one thing Sawyer always does for us is let us know every 15 minutes if we're out on a field trip what the weather's going to be. So he's going to be a great meteorologist.
Our next graduate is Ashley Goffman. She graduated from Stephen Decatur High School. Ashley plans to attend Warwick Community College and then transfer to Salisbury University to pursue a nursing degree.
Our next graduate is Carly Hoffman, Ashley's cousin. She is graduating from Worcester Preparatory School and she plans to attend Mount St. Mary's University.
Our next graduate is Erin Hurley. She also graduated from Stephen Decatur High School. She earned straight A's all 15 terms of high school. Erin will be attending St. Mary's College to major in biology.
Then we have Laura Meadows, who is also a member of our church and our youth group. Laura is graduating from Stephen Decatur High School with honors, where she was active in drama, show choir, and on the tennis team. Laura will be attending Towson University to study graphic design and theater.
The next graduate is Aiden O'Connor. He also graduated from Stephen Decatur High School. Aiden will attend Warwick Community College to earn an associate's degree in engineering. He will then transfer to Virginia Commonwealth University in Richmond to finish a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering. And his dad also just received his MBA. Lee O'Connor.
Next we have Matthew Piles, who is a Stephen Decatur graduate. We're not really sure what Matthew's plans are for his future, but we know whatever he decides to do that he's going to succeed and be great at it.
Our next graduate is Owen Dennis. He graduated from Salisbury University with a major in math and a minor in computer programming. Owen had a 4.0 GPA. He was awarded the Most Promising Mathematician Award. Owen is currently working at Wallace Island as a data analyst.
And then we have Aaron Smith, who graduated from Christopher Newport University with a BA in biology. Aaron will be continuing on to UMES this fall to complete her doctorate in physical therapy. So congratulations to everybody. We did have one lady at our 8 o'clock service, who her name is Erica, who also graduated from Salisbury University with a degree in nursing. So we are so proud of everybody.
Everybody a hand.
Side. and Sir Dean Robinson. After graduation, I joined my family as a fourth-generation farmer at Smith Farms in Michigan. While my senior year was cut short, I missed out on a lot of memory-making moments. I am grateful for the support of my family, friends, and church. God bless.
Hi, my name is Karen Smith, and I'm a member of the community church and am the daughter of Dean M. Robinson. I graduated from Christopher Newport University, magna cum laude, with a Bachelor of Arts in Biology and minors in Business Administration and Leadership Studies. I've been accepted into the University of Maryland Eastern Shore Doctor of Physical Therapy program to complete my doctorate in the fall.
Let us pray together. God of your goodness, give me yourself, for you are sufficient for me. I cannot properly ask anything less to be worthy of you. If I were to ask less, I should always be in want. In you alone do I have all.
Through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us.
Dear friends, this is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
We are blessed with a great program of music. I have mentioned to you that unfortunately the choir cannot sing, but however, Dick certainly can play. And I invite you to listen to a hymn that I think is one of my very, very favorites. I think probably for most of you, How Great Thou Art.
Thank you.
know, the day will come when we can sing again in church. And as I've said, we do things for the well-being not only of ourselves, but out of genuine concern for others.
Dick, I just want you to know that in my mind, I was singing along with you, and I was even in my mind on key.
Doesn't happen often in real life. I'd like you to take just a moment and as we go into a period of time of prayer, just allow your thoughts and your hearts to turn to God and to silently lift those concerns and those things that you know belong with God to Him. And for me, that's all of life, even the smallest detail. And I just encourage you to allow for a moment to take a brief period of silence for God to speak to you and remind you how deeply beloved you are by your pastor, by your church staff, but most of all by God. And just in a few moments after that period of silence, I will pray. So let us pray together. Almighty and wonderful God, it feels so good to be home. We understand and we know that you are with us wherever we go and wherever this journey in life might take us. That if we go on vacation, you're with us. And if we go to a hospital or to a nursing home, you are already there. We know that you're with us at home or we go to the grocery store or wherever business concerns might take us. But in some special and wonderful way, this is home. We know that you're not only here, that this building doesn't hold you and that we come back from Sunday to Sunday just to see you and visit, but somehow it's special. And we understand that. And we're glad to be here. We give thanks to God for all that God has continued to do for us and in us during these difficult days. May we not only focus this morning, wonderful and caring Christ, on the things, the stuff, the possessions, the money that we need or want, but may we also know that God is doing something special in us to prepare us for the next step in our growth and our use and service to the kingdom of God. Gracious and loving God, we pray for these graduates. We give thanks for whether they want to be a farmer or a brain surgeon or a meteorologist or anything in between. We know that through you, they can do great things in this world. Help them to be that whatever they do, to be cognizant of the fact that work is valuable, that work brings meaning to our lives and serves the lives of others. And that through you, we can give witness to the greatness of God. We give thanks today for doctors and nurses and persons who are on medical staffs and researchers who are working so hard to find a cure or a solution, a way ahead. Keep them safe and protect them. We give thanks today for persons who are here and those who will be listening on and watching on virtual, online, and all the members and persons of this great family of God. We ask that you keep them safe. And for those who are struggling with health concerns or worries or anxiety or fear, any way at all, we pray that your presence and peace would rest and abide upon them. Gracious and living God, we give thanks for this nation. And regardless of our political affiliation, we pray for our leaders and for the nations of the world and its leaders. Help us to realize the value of every human life.
And help us, particularly our young adults, to find ways to solve problems other than through the use of violence. We pray for persons who are protesting, and we pray for law enforcement persons as well. May we be a nation that looks in the faces of each other and finds there a sister or a brother, someone whom we can love and live beside and with. And wonderful Christ, on this day, help us to always be thankful for the fact that you are with us and that you promise to see us through, and that nothing is impossible for you. And let us pray today with the confidence of the children of God. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. got untangled. Hello, my name is Kathy Carrier, and this morning I will read Genesis 18, verses 1 through 15. I think you'll find it's a familiar story. The Lord appeared to Abraham near the trees of Mamre while he was sitting at the entrance of the tent during the heat of the day. Abraham looked up and saw three men standing nearby. When he saw them, he hurried from the entrance to the tent to meet them and bowed low to the ground. He said, "If I have found favor in your eyes, my Lord, do not pass your servant by. Let a little water be brought, and you may all wash your feet and rest under the tree. Let me get you something to eat so you can be refreshed, and then you can go on your way. Now that you have come to your servant." "Very well," they answered. "We will do as you say." So Abraham hurried into the tent to Sarah. "Quick," he said, "get three sahs of the finest flour and knead it into some bread." Then he ran to the herd and selected a choice, tender calf and gave it to a servant who hurried to prepare it. He then brought some curds and milk and the calf that had been prepared and set these before them. While they ate, he stood near them under a tree. "Where is your wife Sarah?" they asked him. "There in the tent," he said. One of them said, "I will surely return to you about this time next year, and Sarah, your wife, will have a son." Now Sarah was listening at the entrance to the tent, which was behind him. Abraham and Sarah were very old. Sarah was past the age of childbearing. So Sarah laughed to herself, and she thought, "After I am worn out, my husband is old, now I have this pleasure?" Then the Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Will I really have a child now that I am this old?' Is anything too hard for the Lord? I will return to you at the appointed time next year, and Sarah will have a son." Sarah was afraid, so she lied and said, "I did not laugh." But he said, "Yes, you did laugh." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Every time I take my mask off, I have to wait for a moment for my glasses to defog. Let us pray together. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, my rock and my redeemer. Many years ago, as I moved through the process of ordination, I came to the requirement where to be ordained, you had to appear before the, was then called the clergy executive session of annual conference. And you were brought in down the aisle, and as you were walking down the aisle, your biography was read. You shook hands with the bishop, who for me was Bishop Peter Weaver, if you all might remember me. And then the executive session of annual conference, all the clergy present from this conference had the right and privilege to ask you almost any question they wanted. Yes, it is as terrifying as it sounds. I was praying my hardest, best, most fearsome prayers, "Lord, please, no questions." God did not answer those prayers. I had two questions, one of which was asking me about the fact, as I've told you, that in Pocomoke growing up, Mom and Dad took me to every kind of church you can imagine. They, I think, still pray that it was made a big difference for me. Yes, it did. He sounds so good. It's great to hear a little child. And that question, I don't really remember it other than the question itself. I don't remember who asked it. I have a sneaky suspicion that it was Boyd Etter. Well, I'm not sure, but you know. But it was the second question that for me became the most important question of my life. A seminal question. It was totally out of the blue that God had someone inspired to ask this question that has affected me every day of my life since that moment. It was asked by the Reverend Dr. Jefferson Wadala. Now, I don't know if you know Jeff or not, but Jeff is from the continent of Africa. I said in the early service, Nigeria, actually he's from Liberia. And Jeff and I, and even Jeff's brother, remain very close friends. Jeff is now unable to serve, and he is living in the Easton area. Beautiful, wonderful Christian man. And in Jeff's Liberian accent, he said, "Dale, tell me, what place, what role does grace play in your life and ministry?" I don't know why, but that moment, that question has stayed with me all of my life. I am so thankful that as a believer in Jesus Christ, as a son of God the Father, in the sense of being an heir, a person of faith, that I have received grace time and time and time again, and that my sins, my personal mistakes, my wrongdoings are not held against me. It's not because it's merited or deserved. It's because of the graciousness of God. But I also spend time each day asking myself, how can I be gracious and grace-sharing to the people I meet? That includes you. That includes people that I might come in contact with at the grocery store or at 7-Eleven or in other locations. Anyone I meet during that day, how may I be gracious and kind and represent Christ to them? Every morning, that's one of the first things on my mind. And when I go to bed at night, I take a moment, I try to examine and ask where I failed and maybe where I was successful. You know, in life, we all want answers. We know that 4 plus 4 equals 8, and 12 times 12 is 144. We know that the Orioles will someday win the pennant again. We know all of these things. We know about when to plant and when to harvest. We know all the kinds of stuff. We want answers to our questions, solutions, fixes, sometimes quick fixes. But I would say to you that maybe the questions are more important than the answers. Our text hinges on a very important question. Did you catch it while Kathy was reading? That question is this: is anything too hard for the Lord? Now, as you sit there, you and I know the right answer, don't we? We know the answer that we're supposed to give, that we've been taught to give. We know the answer that is the right one for good church-going, faithful people here. But do we know it here? Do we know it deep down inside when life gets tough, or as John Guest used to write, when life tumbles in, do we know that answer? Is anything too hard for the Lord? I want to point out a couple things to you about this text. One is that Abraham is talking to God. It says the Lord appeared to Abraham. And Abraham is talking to God. And Abraham is a person of great faith. But he puts God on hold for a few moments because he spies these three visitors. We don't know who or what the visitors are. They're talked about as strangers, in some translations as visitors. But we do know that later in the text, they're referred to as the Lord. What we do know is that they have a divine and important
important divine message for Abraham. I also want you to note with me the importance of hospitality in the ancient world. The reason Abraham pauses with God is so that he can offer appropriate hospitality in his culture. He welcomes these strangers with food and water and rest and looks after their needs. Thursday's sermon, where I told you I'm preaching different sermons so that if you really want to suffer, you can hear me twice a week, is that hospitality helps us to see God in the stranger, in the other person. And in the midst of this hospitality, Sarah helps Abraham, and they hear the message of the covenant of promise. In a year from now, Sarah will have a child. Now, we know that that child is named Isaac, and we know that that child is the heir that God has promised to Abraham. God has promised to Abraham land and security and presence and to have an heir to make out of Abraham a great people. And all of it has come true except the last one, right? And Abraham tried to help God out by having a child with Hagar and naming that child Ishmael, but it didn't go real well. So Sarah laughed. She text says she laughed at herself, but obviously it was loud enough, great enough, that persons could hear. And one of the messengers, one of those three persons, says, "Why does Sarah laugh?" To which Sarah responds at the end almost like there's a dialogue between a three-year-old and a parent. "I didn't laugh." And the messenger says, "Yes, you did. I can hear my mom saying that to me when I was a kid." So the question around which this text hinges is anything too hard for the Lord? Let me give you two examples from Scripture, one from the Old and one from the New, of places that we see where God's great power and might overcomes extreme difficulty, and where we can take heart from that experience as well. The first is the story of David and Goliath. I love that story. It's one of my very, very favorite stories. And you remember little David that wasn't big enough to wear Saul's armor, and little David who everybody thought could not do anything against the great Goliath. And Goliath's description in the Old Testament means that he's taller and bigger than Shaquille O'Neal. And that's one big dude. And yet David doesn't hesitate out and to fight him. All of the other members of the Israelite army and David's own family are cowered behind one of the hills in the valley of Elah. On the other side are the Philistines, and Goliath would come out every day and challenge them and make fun of their God and tell them they're not men and all kinds of stuff. And everybody was terrified except for David. And while the text doesn't specifically phrase the question this way, "Is anything too hard for the Lord?" David wholeheartedly, faithfully would have said, "Not on your life." So he goes out to face Goliath, and Goliath mocks him and makes fun of him. And he says, "What is this, a boy that you send out against me? Can't you send out a man? I don't want to hurt him. He's pitiful." And David says this, "Goliath, you come against me with sword and shield and spear and buckler and all of this, but I come against you in the name of the Lord our God, who has been with me when I slew the lion and the bear, and who is with me today. Is anything too hard for the Lord?" And with that, David took a rock, and someone who is better in English is going to have to help me. I don't know whether you throw it from a slingshot or what you do, but he got the rock and it went,
and it hit David in the, it hit Goliath in the forehead, and Goliath fell down dead. Is anything too hard for the Lord? David would have said, not at all. And for the New Testament, the life of Jesus, you ask that question again, is anything too hard for the Lord? Jesus calmed the Sea of Galilee. He healed all kinds of diseases. He fed the multitudes. He raised the dead. And even on Easter Sunday morning, he himself rose from the dead and lives today. Even death, our greatest enemy, could not hold him. Is anything too hard for the Lord? We know that the answer is no. But in the midst of a pandemic and unemployment and economic concerns and businesses asking whether they will fail or succeed, in the midst of violence in our streets and racial unrest, in the midst of even what's been happening on the boardwalk in Ocean City, we ask ourselves, is anything too hard for the Lord? And sometimes we're led to ponder. We're led to wonder. We might ask, where is God? But I can say to you, our God is a trustworthy God. Our God is powerful and great and awesome and mighty. God can handle any problem or difficulty that comes through the world concerns, but also knows and loves us and can handle any concern that comes from deep within our hearts, in our personal lives, and the lives of those we love. Is anything too hard for the Lord? The answer is no. Whether it be a concern of nations or a concern that you and I have. So let me close this morning by saying two things. First, what is required? Second, what is the outcome? First, what is required? Simply faith. Were I to have a Bible with me other than on my cell phone this morning, I could take you to Hebrews chapter 11, and you would find there Abraham again. And he is in what you might call a hall of fame of faith, and he is the top person. Because God spoke to him in Genesis 12, and he never asked a question, never doubted, never equivocated. He simply followed. And throughout the stories of the patriarchs, Abraham is held up as an example of faith and of trust, complete confidence in God. And in Hebrews, he is listed as one of those who the writer of Hebrews will describe as one of whom the world was not worthy. Abraham had great trust and faith in God. You might say to me, but Dale, I'm not there. I'm not Abraham. But I would remind you that in the New Testament it says this, if you have faith as small as a grain or a seed of mustard seed plant, God can do great things. We are reminded that our faith is not measured by its quantity or its size, but by the greatness of God. And I'm willing to trust the second thing, what is the outcome? Do you know the word Isaac, the name Isaac means? Anybody know what the name Isaac means? You can confound your friends and family with this one now. The name Isaac means laughter. Sarah laughed. The word in Hebrew, Isaac, means laughter. It's an ironic play on words. But even more than that, can you imagine being there when old Abraham and old Sarah witnessed the birth of this baby? Can you even imagine the joy it brings? Celebration, joy, thankfulness, laughter is the outcome of knowing that nothing is too hard for the Lord. You know, friends, I don't know where you are today in thinking. I'm so proud of you for being here and trying and seeing and maybe stepping out of your comfort zone. Have faith in God. And God will bring you joy. And you will turn the morning into day. dancing and your pain into laughter. Amen. We're going to take a moment, and I'm going to tell you about the offering. Now, we're not able to pass plates, so don't think that you're going to be receiving a plate from the usher. But as you exit that door, there is an offering box. It's a locked box. It's secure. Just simply slide your offering into that locked box. That's one of the ways that we felt we could continue to honor the restrictions and the guidelines from the state and from our bishop. And Maud, I think, wrote this because it sounds much better than what I could write. The offering we receive is used for the glory of God and the regular expenses of the church. Those items like heat, cleaning, and many other items are all paid for by your faithful and generous giving. But even more, in these times of great need, persons are fed, clothed, cared for medically, and evangelized because you give to God through this offering. Thank each of you so very much for being faithful to God. And we do give our offering to the glory and honor of God this day. I'm going to turn to Dick, who plays beautifully. And I thought, as I chose hymns this morning, having comforting, familiar hymns would offer us a moment of peace in our hearts and minds and souls. And so please listen as Dick plays Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
Socks off next time that it comes. But, you know, we're going to
put you to you, then just follow the guidance of your ushers. But if you and you guys, the ushers and Terry, will kind of help make sure that there's not a line for communion as well. I'm going to dart out to the side, and I will be out just outside that door, and I'll wave to you as you leave, except that I really need this mask. Other than that, have a great afternoon. May God bless you. Congratulations. I hope you're proud to be a farmer. I've often said I love to grow things. I love to grow things, but I think if my career depended upon farming, I'd be working for you. So have great congratulations to all our graduates. Let's pray. Wonderful Christ, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, may He bless you, keep you now and forever. Amen. Go to peace. As the ushers will.